Estás loco. Completamente loco, Roberto. Mendoza.
No, no más. No. No voy a decir nada. No. Ay, no. No. ¡Al carajo! Roberto. Roberto Asanti.
¿Esto puede durar todo el día? ¿O puede terminarse ahora?
¡Piñeros! ¡Piñeros!
You'll be seeing your sister soon.
Yes. Why were those men killed?
It was necessary.
They were our people. They were comrades. Mendoza says they will hunt us down. He says they will destroy everything we have worked for.
Mendoza is a fool.
Roberto. Tell me the truth.
Truth is... that you know too much.
But you must let me talk to the American ambassador immediately. Tell him what I have told you, but for God's sake, tell him. It is a matter of great importance, I assure you. Huertas! Cierra las puertas!
Mendoza!
No.
Who else has seen this at the FBI?
The director and myself, Mr. President.
What about the CIA?
Myself, the director, and the assistant director, Dawson, Mr. President.
Why didn't they find it last year when they searched the wreck?
It dropped more than a mile away along with some pieces of the aircraft.
Maybe it's a plant.
I don't think so, sir. It was in a locked briefcase. We analyzed the handwriting. It's the vice president's signature.
Why? The Vice President of the United States pull something like this?
Because he thought he could get away with it.
That was uncalled for, Dietrich.
Jerry, you're getting paranoid. Toronto's a piece of cake.
That's what they said about Dallas.
Excuse me, Mr. President. Herb Morris and Jerry O'Connor are outside to see you.
Not now.
They seem to feel it is very important that they speak with you, sir.
Well, what's it about?
It's about this.
got 5 minutes. You make it count.
Hello, Herb. How's Wyatt?
Fine, thanks.
Jerry?
Mr. President.
Well, gentlemen.
Mr. President, I have a friend who works for the American Embassy in Argentina. About a week ago, they received a call from a high-ranking member of the Mano Verde.
Do what?
It's a Marxist organization, operates throughout South America.
All right, go on.
Well, sir, the man wanted to talk to the ambassador, but he was shot before they could put the call through. He mentioned your visit this week, and, excuse me, sir, the name of this man here, Roberto Asante.
Asante's dead. He died with Guevara in Bolivia.
His body was never found.
If he was still around, we'd have heard of it.
My contacts said they called the CIA, but your boys weren't interested.
I wondered why.
So did I when I heard the story.
Educated at MIT, the Kharsov Institute, Leningrad, fought with Castro, Guevara's political commissar in Bolivia, and a hero to millions of South Americans. He's quite a fellow.
He's reputed to be the man behind Duvalier's assassination.
You really think this man is still alive, O'Connor?
Everything points to it, Mr. President.
Everything meaning questionable intelligence.
There's nothing questionable about the three bodies that were found outside of Pinheiro's last week. One of them was a known associate of Asante's, Mr. President. An ex-weatherman named Erica Steiner. Her throat was cut.
For Christ's sake, O'Connor, so what?
So the silly girl gets herself involved with pros and gets her throat cut. Happens all the time. She was probably running drugs.
I doubt that. She and her sister Linda were political activists as far back as the 60s. No drug record.
Well, simply because...
Well, I don't think you...
gentlemen, assuming that this man is still alive and assuming that he has something planned for me on the 8th, what do you propose to do? We notify all ports of entry and the RCMP. It's their jurisdiction.
Mr. President, we'd like to change your route in Toronto. Add more security.
If we could avoid the crowd, sir, the outdoor events, I think...
All right, I'll take your advice under consideration. Thank you, gentlemen.
What the hell are you trying to prove going up against a guy like Dietrich?
He's covering his ass. The CIA had orders to terminate Asante. They blew it.
Jerry, if ever you want to become head of this service, you'd better learn to play politics.
President's life's in danger. You want me to brown nose?
Jerry.
Our two great nations must now develop a unified energy program which will make our nations independent of the oil cartels.
It's cluttered.
It is, isn't it?
Toronto is an interesting city, they tell me.
Yeah, so they say. On a good day, it'd be nice to get out and drive around.
Then what kind of car?
Why?
My hair. Riding in those open cars takes more lacquer than a Chinese chest.
Nice try, kid. You've been talking to O'Connor?
Oh, please don't.
Herb Morris.
Adam, please.
If it was up to those guys, I'd be riding around in a Sherman tank. But I have to be out in the open where I can see people, talk to them, touch.
Adam, I can't go on like this any longer. Flinching every time I hear a motorcycle backfire.
All right.
Oh, I'm sorry.
I hurt you?
No, I'm okay.
Are you all right?
Which way are you going?
I'm just trying to get out of here.
Right here. To your left.
Where?
Need some help?
Excuse me, sir. The vice president is here to see you now.
Fine. Send him in.
Adam, I find this incredible. With all due respect, I fail to see what concern this private communication is to the director of the FBI or the president of the United States.
Ethan, and I'm reading from the letter. I couldn't let the day go by without letting you know how much I appreciate this latest expression of your thoughtfulness. Beth gave me the package you sent around last night.
Joe was a friend.
What do you expect me to believe this package was? A bunch of bananas?
No.
How much was it then? How much?
$25,000. But I put it in the bank. It's still there.
Ethan, I want you off the ticket. I can't have some newspaper hotshot blowing this thing up into another Watergate. I'm sorry. I want your resignation on this desk by the time I get
back. You helped to put that man in the White House. It should have been you, not him. Now, you've got to fight him, Ethan.
I can't. It would split the party.
Damn the party. All those sons of bitches are out there sitting on a fence.
Honey, that's the way the game is played. I knew the rules when I get into it.
There are no rules, Ethan, but the ones you make. Besides, what's $25,000 to Joe Springlass? He was enormously wealthy.
Well, according to the FBI and the Treasury Department, Joe was enormously wealthy because he was using his company to import illegal drugs in partnership with organized crime. I thanked him for his latest thoughtfulness. Well, what am I supposed to say? That I was talking about our anniversaries and birthdays? If you were a reporter for the Washington Post, would you buy that?
Damn you, Ethan. God damn. Damn you!
You got any lights in here?
Your sister. There was an ambush. She got caught in the crossfire. She was shot in the back as she tried to reach us.
Bastards.
Linda. Linda. We'll make them pay for it.
Chief McKenzie.
Mr. O'Connor, welcome to Toronto.
Thank you. My assistant, Michael Komsky.
Mr. Komsky,
nice to be here.
Well, the car's waiting.
Chief, have you received the fact sheets on Sandy?
I passed them over to Chief Superintendent Bradley of the RCMP. He's a good man.
The rear compartment is composed of two walls. On the outside is a steel wall, and on the inside is a fake plywood wall, which is painted to look like steel. Now, between these two walls, I've hooked up heat sensors, three per wall. Movement sensors, in case they try to move the truck, and an electrified grid. Now, in the cab, you'll find the control panel for all of these things. It has individual switches and a master switch.
Where does the explosives fit in?
They're interconnected to the three systems which I just described. Plus, the remote receivers, which have antennas in the front and the back.
What are you trying to tell me?
The frequency can be jammed, yes. Which is why I suggest that you keep in visual contact with the vehicle at all times.
What is the density of the grid?
Well, that's something that I had a little problem with. I couldn't get enough of the commercial stuff, so I had to... There's a lot of paranoid people around. I had to wire it up myself.
You did what?
I had to wire it up myself with what I had.
Well, how much wire did you use?
There's 1,000 feet of wiring in that truck!
What am I working here with?
It took me a week to do it!
Roberto, Harvey has worked very hard on this, and he's done an excellent job.
This vehicle is impregnable. Do you know what that means? That means that once that master switch is thrown, there's no way into it. No way.
Harvey, I'd like you to be by my side tomorrow.
Is this the one?
Yes, that's the son.
You have a fact sheet? We didn't distribute it.
Oh, no.
CIA report lists him as deceased.
Can you have that photograph and the fact sheet printed up for all security personnel for tomorrow?
Look, my men are already overloaded with fact sheets. Now, if the agency isn't worried about them.
Just to be on the safe side.
All right.
Frightening, isn't it? A giant step. An irrevocable step.
But necessary. America needs to learn humility. Our leaders are all so arrogant. Maybe this will show them just how vulnerable they really are.
Perhaps.
Hi, we're back on Twilight Country, and I sure do appreciate your company tonight. Now, here's our homegrown queen of country, Miss Guidona Lee, and her newest hitbound release, Do You Dream?
Erica used to write me about you. She said you fought with Guevara in Bolivia.
For a short time.
He's a great man. What was he like?
You or me? A man dedicated to the destruction of the capitalist tyranny. Ah, it sounds too strident. He was a man that was interested in justice for all men.
Could I have a cigarette?
There you go.
Thanks. She loved you.
That's so hard to believe.
No. Not at all.
Presidents can never be fully protected from every potential threat. Secret Service's difficulties vary with the nature of the occupant of the presidency and his willingness to conform with plans for his safety. The president that I am sworn to protect is very often careless with his safety. That's why I am asking, pleading with you for your total cooperation, total alertness tomorrow. Ever since Dallas, we've been indoctrinated with the idea of assassination attempts being made from a distance. Nothing could be further from the truth. And I suggest Bobby Kennedy and George Wallace as examples. Facts are, most assassination attempts are made at close quarters, 10, maybe 15 feet at the most. So don't waste your time looking for the suspicious bulge, the bomb, the gun. Concentrate on the faces. Only the faces. You'll see it in the eyes. Something weird about the mouth, something about the face itself that doesn't quite fit. That'll be all, gentlemen. Thank you very much.
That's a hell of a stack.
Yeah, let's go have a beer.
Hold it in, Sergeant. No, I don't mean your stomach.
Considerations at least lurk in the background of most important decisions made today.
President?
So, oh, come in, Herb.
Hi, Herb. I've had a call from Jerry O'Connor. It seems that not much has been done about that Asante thing, you know?
Oh, yeah. Well, I talked to Dietrich again. He still thinks the intelligence is pretty raw. And even assuming the man is alive, we have no idea what he's after.
I think it's safe to assume if he's alive, he's after you.
Well, Kennedy said it.
They want you badly enough, they're gonna...
Get you.
Yeah, I'll bet every one of us back to Lincoln has thought about it. Are you okay?
Oh, yes, I'm fine.
Herb, I'm sorry I don't see it your way, but this trip is too important to run scared.
Oh, it's all right, I understand. Mr. Scott?
Well,
what a big day. The big day is here. Here we go.
Herbie, relax.
What?
Relax.
I am relaxed. What are you talking about? I'm completely relaxed. Oh, it's really good to see you two getting along so well.
You certainly have a lovely city.
Aye, you'll have to admit, we've given you a lovely day.
I hate to tell you this, Chief, but a lovely day for a presidential appearance. It's in a heavy rain.
For the rest of your mortal days, understood?
Loud and clear, sir.
Special Agent O'Connor, we have a top priority message from Air Force One. Report to Toronto International Airport immediately.
Roger.
The CIA does not have any authority in this matter.
I'm sorry, Calvin, but I think we do have authority in this matter. O'Connor doesn't have the goddamn experience.
Jerry O'Connor is the senior man here, and he's the only one fully briefed on all aspects of security.
Well, if you ask me, you are making a big mistake putting O'Connor in charge.
The president wants it that way.
Calvin, it's a mistake.
See, everything's going real smoothly.
What's that?
What? What's what?
That.
Looks like the engine's overheating.
Hey, a problem.
Did you fill it?
I filled it, yeah.
Are you sure?
Why?
Well?
I did.
Just slow down.
We're in a situation that's becoming critical and will certainly not improve. And it would be foolish, of course, for us not to to look for alternate sources of energy. We've got to explore the energy sources of the sun. The wind, there have been some suggestions made that we should go back to wind ships. You can achieve something like 20 knots under sail, 18 knots under sail. There are a lot of things we can do. We can wear long underwear, for heaven's sake. When I was a kid, we wore long underwear to keep warm. The homes weren't heated the way they are now. I mean, I spent a lot of time on the farm when I was a kid, and I used to sleep upstairs under the eaves when I woke up in the winter. I kept the window open.
Problems?
Yep. Oh, yeah, we got problems. Lots
Watch
of problems.
It, you fry your hands.
Oh, thanks.
What do you carry?
Egg Foo Young.
That's a new one.
Actually, it is Egg Foo Young.
Here's your water.
Thank you.
Money and confidential records.
She's an old one, isn't she?
Oh, yeah, she's old. Oh, yeah, real old. More directly, do we insulate
ourselves? The things God put all around us. And I think we've got to get back to a more direct relationship. Just put on an extra pair of socks. I think we have to develop a
What's your route?
That's none of your business.
Downtown, Eaton's department store.
Well, you better get a move on. They're cordoning off that whole area for the president's
visit. Resources are here.
That's right.
These three countries, and if we want to develop a
stronger sense. What the hell's that?
What's what?
That.
The United States, and he's going to be here in Toronto today.
Jim! Oh.
I'm
the president of the United States right here, and you guys here exclusively.
What the hell going on?
Shoot. Shoot him! Shoot! Give me the gun. Get inside. Carry on. How much time do we have left?
48 minutes.
Hey, we'll get back to the music in just a second. I've just been handed a special announcement for you. The President of the United States will arrive at the Toronto International Airport as scheduled. However, a bit of a mix-up here. The presidential motorcade is going to be delayed just about half an hour due to a reported mishap aboard Air Force One. And they'll now arrive at Nathanville Square just about 3 o'clock instead of the original scheduled time, which is about 2:30, I believe.
Fly, 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 fly.
stand shut.
Thank you, gentlemen. Well, looks like you're in charge of protecting these tired bones now, O'Connor. Sorry about the circumstances.
Don't worry, Jerry. Herb will be all right.
I suggest we use the closed car for the motorcade, Mr. President.
Well, O'Connor, the Prime Minister thought I might enjoy a breath of clean Canadian air. Might be diplomatically acceded to his wishes.
You make the decisions, Mr. President.
That's true. And I'll go right on making them.
Yes, sir.
Oh, yes. Perhaps this is a good point in time to remind you, O'Connor, that the Secret Service was designed for the President, not the President for the Secret Service.
I understand, Mr. President.
Then let's get going.
You can't get through here. It's out of bounds.
What do you mean I can't get through here?
The president is coming.
Look, I just want to get in here and deliver this money and go home.
Look, man, I'm sorry. You can't
get through. Look, I've got $50,000 in this truck to deliver to these people. Do you want to be responsible for that?
Okay.
I didn't mean to.
All right.
Thanks. Hey, Carter, you see that?
Yeah, banks. Must be coming to the store here.
Are they scheduled?
Look. I don't show banks at all. I think I better call in.
You don't show a banks truck at Eaton's Komsky? Call the chief dispatcher at banks, find out what the hell's going on.
All right.
The truck looks empty, sir, and locked.
You stay with the truck, Willis. Get someone to find the driver.
Roger.
All right, Mr. Portinelli, 10 seconds, please.
Reaction from the American president for the Mexican press. Look, from the Mexican press.
You Mexican?
Si, senor.
Behind the line.
This is Valerie Martinelli at Nathan Phillips Square. Excuse me, madam. Would you please tell me what you think of the president's visit to Toronto?
Oh, I think it's wonderful.
Yes, I agree. Excuse me, please. I can see the president now.
Mr. O'Connor, sir, we've searched Seaton Center, but we can't find the drivers.
Stay with him, Willis. Stay with him.
Hey! Who are you and what are you doing? Open up!
Repeat that, please. I can't hear you.
Jerry, it's McKenzie here. Do you read me?
Jerry, come. Jerry. Bank truck.
Repeat, please. You're breaking up.
Jerry.
Jerry, that bank's truck is moving towards the square. Jerry, do you read me?
McKenzie, repeat. I can't hear you. I can't hear you.
The bank's truck is moving towards the square.
Well, don't let that bloody truck get any further.
Jesus Christ! Come on, you guys, get back in there! Get these people back! Get them back!
Mrs. Scott, smiling radiantly, is wearing a cream wool coat with a silver fox collar.
Thank you.
Yes.
Them to cease fire.
God damn it, I said cease fire. Cease fire. Cease fire. Cease fire.
This is ridiculous. This man isn't gonna blow himself up. Come on, O'Connor, arrest him. Get this thing off me.
One move and we're all dead.
O'Connor?
Santi.
I'm taking this man to that truck.
Hell you are.
Please do as he says. I know this man.
I have a friend in the square with a remote device, the same device that detonated the first explosion. Now, if I'm not moving towards that truck in a matter of seconds, there'll be a much larger explosion and your president will be dead.
Get these people out of here. Everybody, stand back. Give them room. Now let's move towards the truck. Slowly. Nice and slow.
And easy.
You're nuts, you know. You'll never get away with this.
Please do as he says, Mr. President.
But you won't.
Back off! Don't back off! Move!
Well, what do you want?
Everything will be explained as soon as we're in the truck.
Do we let him put him in that truck?
We don't have any other choice. He's wired with enough explosives to blow up half the square, and somebody out there is holding a backup detonator. All right.
No.
Please, Mr. President, this man is Roberto Asante, believe me. He means what he says.
You listen to him, Mr. President.
Open the door, and I'll follow you in slowly. Remember, don't you do anything that might alarm my friend.
Let that man take the president inside the truck.
He's got 30 sticks of dynamite strapped to his chest.
Christ almighty. O'Connor, I'm taking over.
Mr. Dietrich, isn't it?
Who the hell are you?
Mackenzie, chief of police. And you're not taking over anything, Mr. Dietrich. I am.
Jack, get all those people back. I want this whole area cleared and get the bomb squad here on the double.
Look, chief, listen. That is the American president inside that truck. He is our president, our responsibility.
He's in my country, Mr. Dietrich. And this is metropolitan Toronto. You have no jurisdiction here. I think Mr. O'Connor and I are quite capable of handling this.
I want everybody to remain calm, very calm. And let's clear the square completely.
Kamsky, get him! Stay with the truck!
I'll stick with that truck! Stick with it! Stick with it! Come on, move up! Move up, Jack! Let's get going on this!
Leave those people on the south side of the street. And keep those police officers away from them. Just leave them where they are.
Like this. I don't like leaving these crowds about.
It's a cover for his Confederate.
United States is my prisoner.
He's unarmed and will remain unharmed just as long as my instructions are followed.
This truck contains a large quantity of high explosives. It also contains
sophisticated electronic equipment. Any attempt to tamper with it will cause it to detonate.
I assure you, this truck is unassailable.
This action is being taken on behalf of the People's Progressive Army. And on behalf of all of those who gave their lives in the fight for freedom.
You won't get away with this, you know.
You might be right. Then again, your fate hinges on mine. And in the end, that's all that matters. Isn't it? President of the United States.
What do you want?
First,
I want an escort to room 417 of that building. Now, someone is liable to get impatient, and that could be fatal for all of us.
Cuff him.
Mackenzie here. We're bringing him up to headquarters. I want the way kept clear.
It's unbelievable in this day and age.
Yes.
Would the people on the south side of the square please remain where they are until directed otherwise by the police? Please remain behind the police barriers and stay calm. Do not panic.
This is Charles Evans reporting from the
White House. Do we know what they want yet?
Reaction from around the world has been one of shock. In Moscow,
what about Mrs. Scott?
The Russian premier has expressed horror.
All right, assemble the cabinet immediately.
Chinese government has issued statements declaring that no...
What's going on, Ethan?
Somebody's kidnapped the president.
Who, the Russians?
Some crackpot from South America. Who is it?
Mr. Richards, your car is waiting, sir.
I'll be right out.
Well, honey, I guess that makes you the acting president.
Mr. O'Connor, this is a very delicate political situation, the implications of which we cannot even begin to comprehend.
I realize that, sir. Right now, there was only one thing on my mind, to get the president out of that truck. Mr. Prime Minister, I need you to cut through the red tape for me.
Are you suggesting that we turn over the direction of a Canadian law enforcement body to an agent of the U.S. government?
Yes. Unless you want to see various officers and agencies tossing this time bomb back and forth.
How do you plan to handle this terrorist?
I must have exclusive authority to deal with him. While we're looking for a way into the truck. If he smells that we're trying to stall him, he could hit the button on us.
And if you don't succeed, do you pay him off?
That's not up to me, sir. That's up to the cabinet.
All right, Mr. O'Connor. If you want the responsibility, proceed, but quietly. Quietly.
I've been assigned to try and work out this problem.
There's no problem, Mr. Connor. My demands are simple and relatively simple to me. First, $100
million. $100 million. In used, unmarked bills of small denomination. It'll take me about a week and fill a moving van.
No cash.
Gold. Let's see, 100 million will weigh about...
12 ton. No gold. Diamonds.
Done. I'll try.
Oh, you'll manage somehow. Second, two Buffalo transport planes with extra fuel tanks and crew. One for myself and one to spread a radar chaff as it flies ahead of mine.
I have no authority to meet those demands.
Oh, I'm fully aware of that, Mr. Connor. But I'm quite sure you'll pass them on to someone with that authority.
You can be sure of that.
Good. But while you do that, I have to appear at a certain window and make my presence known.
What?
Room 417. See, my friend outside needs to know that no harm has come to me. Every half hour, I must appear at that window and give a signal, looking very much alive. Don't worry, Mr. O'Connor. Nothing will happen to your president, just as long as you comply. Now, you have until midnight, or I'll detonate that truck.
Jerry, I've just had a briefing on the situation from the State Department, and I've called a cabinet meeting for 6 o'clock, but I want an update from you before they arrive. What's the latest on this Asante character?
He wants 2 escape planes and 100 million in diamonds.
Very interesting. And what have you told him?
Nothing. I'm stalling. He's got a Confederate in the crowd with a detonator.
Jerry, if we can't find any other solution, do you think we should pay him?
Well, it's always been my belief that we should drive home the point that the presidency never dies. The man may, even a president as internationally respected as President Kennedy, but the presidency skips a beat and goes on.
Yes, you're absolutely right. I don't know what some of our more opportunistic adversaries might do if they discover we're insecure enough to hand over 100 million to a bunch of Banana Republic terrorists. What's your sense of this man? Can we stonewall him?
I think he could kill the president if we do.
Well, what would he gain by doing that?
He'll become a martyr to the cause. Either way, we lose. If he gets away with this, he'll be a hero to his people and have 100 million to finance revolutions all over South America.
If we pay, can we trust him not to detonate the truck anyway?
He's a terrorist, sir. He could kill the president.
I'll be back to you.
On a team working on the electronics of that detonating system, and try and find a way to jam. Report to me every half hour.
Sure thing.
What's the word on the Buffalo aircraft?
They're available.
Range, speed?
Man, with the extra tanks he's asked for, the range is 3,500 miles. Speed is 230 miles an hour. That plane could land him anywhere.
He's thought of everything. What about the radar jet?
Depending on how far ahead it's traveling and the dispersal pattern used, he could be anywhere in a 400 or 500 mile cloud of stuff that no radar could penetrate.
Have him standing by.
Okay.
I've got to find his ace in the hole, whoever he is.
Correction, whoever she is. I just had the report from the forensic lab. The hair's found in the bank's hat in the underground garage. Belonged to a female.
A female?
A blonde.
Two boys in Argentina run a check on Erica Steiner. Wire photo pictures of the body, close-ups of the face, and give me some pictures of Linda Steiner, too.
In the event that the president is unable to discharge the powers and duties of his office, the vice president shall immediately assume the powers and duties of the office as acting president. Mr. Vice President,
If there's no objection, I prefer to remain here, Mr. Chief Justice. May we ask you to stay and lend your presence to our deliberations, John?
Sir, sir.
Since this is a Treasury matter, I'll let Chet Harrison fill you in on the details.
The details are brief and unpleasant. They've got Adam in that damn truck. And they're threatening to kill him if we don't pay $100 million ransom in diamonds. Now, I've already contacted several diamond brokers in New York, and they tell me it won't take more than half an hour to get the diamonds together.
Jesus, Chet, you sound like you're ready to pay for it.
Well, why the hell shouldn't we?
Because you're setting a precedent here. You can't let a handful of thugs Mickey Mouse the national government like that.
Well, I think we ought to sit down and discuss it.
You don't know what you're talking about.
Oh, for the love of God, I've heard nothing but speeches, arguments for the last 40 minutes. Now look, there's a motion on the floor, so call the question.
The question's been called. The motion is to pay the ransom. All those in favor? Opposed.
That's that. Ethan's vote breaks the tie. Terrorists get what they deserve. Nothing.
I really take exception to you casting my vote for me, Saul. Particularly when you haven't the faintest idea of which way I prefer to go. I actually have three options. To vote for the motion, to vote against it, or to declare a conflict of interest and abstain. Am I right, Mr. Chief Justice?
Quite right.
I promise you at the proper time, and if it becomes necessary, I will not abstain. At the moment, however, I would like to invoke this alternative to allow the Secretaries of State and Interior to vote. They will both be in Washington within the hour. If there's no objection, this meeting is adjourned until 8 o'clock.
Just one more item, Mr. Chairman. I have a quote here from the Congressional Investigation into Hijackings in 1974, so it has considerable pertinence. In response to the assertion that if one were inflexible in dealing with hijackers, innocent passengers might well lose their lives, this answer was made. And I quote, "Better to take that risk than to reward criminals and encourage future crime. You do not bend the knee to the tyrant, be he petty or be he strong." These words were uttered by...
Your chairman. 8 o'clock. Promptly, please.
I simply don't understand why Saul Malone would do a thing like that. Why he would deliberately embarrass you by quoting something you said years ago.
Honey, it's something I've said and believed in all my political life. Saul didn't have to go back to 1974 for that.
Then why did he have to bring it up at all?
Honey, you just don't understand. Saul was setting things up for me. What Saul is telling the cabinet is that if I vote not to pay the ransom, it's because that's one of the principles I've stood for all my life. And not just...
Just because you want to be president. You do want the presidency, don't you, Ethan?
I've wanted the presidency all my life, but not this way.
Honey, let's just say that the president gets killed. Oh, God forbid that it should happen, and this spring glass thing comes up. You're going to look like a murderer in a lot of people's eyes. Ethan, your motives got to be questioned. You're the only one that can save him. And if you do, the people are going to remember that. I mean, when nobody else knew what to do, Ethan Richards stepped up and saved a man's life. And he's got to be beholden to you, honey. Spring glass or no spring glass. And the people are going to remember next time.
You know, honey, I've been in politics for over 30 years. And nobody's wanted the presidency more than me. But all I've got to say is I'm glad you're not the one making this decision.
Ethan. Ethan! Ethan!
And it ain't even a bank strut. I mean, it's a pretty good camouflage, but it ain't one of ours.
What makes you think it's that much different from one of yours? I've got to find some way of getting him communication with the president.
There is one possible way, sir. Well, there are tunnels running underneath that entire square. It's the air conditioning vents for the underground garage. Now, I think I could put two men in a tunnel directly under the truck and attach a two-way limpet mic to a joint in the concrete.
But that clown upstairs says the whole thing's wired to blow the moment you touch it.
We reckon they've got heat sensors around the walls of the truck in case anyone tries to torch through it. The walls are sandwiches, aren't they?
Mm-hmm. Got a quarter-inch of plate steel and an inch of cotton batting. That's to stop the bullet. And then another sheet of plate.
Well, the cotton batting might tend to muffle the sound, but that floor is solid steel.
Oh, 2 inches of it.
Which should act like a sounding board once the limpet is attached.
How do you know the limpet won't set the truck off?
We don't know, sir. But it's very unlikely that they would bother with the floor of that truck. That's 2 inches of solid steel.
Plus the drive shaft, the floor bracings, and the rest of it. It's unlikely anyone would try and torch through that.
It's 1,000 to 1, you got to figure it right. But if you haven't, or if someone should see you. Just can't sit here and be pushed around. Take the initiative. Do it.
Have you made our arrangements?
The vice president's having trouble getting his cabinet together.
Look!
You see that trap out there?
It's like the future. A giant time bomb set to explode the old order.
Hey, I'm trying to meet your demands. But I've got problems. I've got two governments to deal with. I've got superiors.
Don't you play me for a fool, O'Connor. Now, I suggest you stop trying to decipher the intricacies of that truck and meet my demands. My patience is wearing thin.
She and her sister have been on our wanted list for over 10 years. They come from an upper-middle-class family. Both went to Radcliffe College, but Linda dropped out to follow her sister around.
Linda Steiner. Get copies of this man
to shoot them right away.
We have the closed-circuit monitors and cameras set up.
We've got 5 of them scanning the crowd now.
We need more.
Where are we going to get them?
Those network trucks out there. Commandeer the damn cameras if you have to. This is an international emergency, and Dietrich, don't do anything without checking with me first.
I wouldn't dream of it.
clouds on.
I shall save him.
Now go near that truck.
I shall save him. The Lord works through
back
me.
Back off.
I am a soldier of the Lord.
Nice and easy.
I am a soldier of Christ. I shall save him. I am a soldier of Christ.
I'm on my knees.
I shall save him.
Come back here. Come here. Come here. I want to talk.
The Lord works through me.
I know that. But come here. I want to talk to you.
I shall save him.
Come here. Hey, come here.
I shall save him. I shall save him.
Come here. We'll talk. We'll talk together. Son, come here.
Oh, Jesus.
We'll work together and save him. Halt! Come back. Freeze. Freeze or I'll shoot.
Something with this girl. She didn't move a muscle for 15 minutes. At 6:30, when Asante gave the signal, the bitch had disappeared.
Put it on live action.
That's not that woman in the photograph. I'll eat that picture.
Can you get any closer? Any closer?
That's it.
That's her. Or is that?
South side of the square.
Sausage and his man are under the truck and they're ready to place the mark.
Tell him to hold it a minute. In her pocket.
Southage and his man are still waiting. Do you want them to start now?
Yeah.
No!
She's got a perfect view of the truck. She spots anything, she'll blow the square sky high. 2 minutes to seven. Why isn't she clicking up at the signal? Come on. Come on. She's looking at the clock. Now!
Go, Pete!
Jerry O'Connor, Mr. President.
We've attached a microphone.
My God, I've never been so glad to hear anyone's voice in my life. I've been sitting here in this damn thing all day, so sorry for myself.
Mr. President, if you could just hold it until after we finish transmission, we'll have much better communications. Over.
All right, sure. Roger, whatever the hell it is I say. Listen, how's my wife?
She's fine, sir. We'll have her here in a minute. Over.
What's my status? Over.
They're holding you for ransom. $100 million. Over.
Don't give them a goddamn cent.
But, Mr. President, if we can't get you out of that truck...
I don't give a damn what happens. Now, listen, Jerry, I want you to call the Secretary of State or whoever you can get a hold of on the cabinet and tell them they're not to pay one thin dime to any terrorists, particularly this son of a bitch.
Will do, sir.
Look, Mr. President, it's absolutely imperative that you describe to me the interior of that truck.
Over. Well, it's empty, but there's a steel box just out of my reach. That's where he put the dynamite.
Anything else? Over. What was that noise, Mr. President?
Well, I've been working on a plywood panel here all day. I finally got it off. You know the inside of this truck is all wood?
No, I didn't know that. Please, for God's sake, don't touch anything, Mr. President.
All right, Jerry. I know you and Morris always wanted to get me in an armored car, but...
Isn't this overdoing it?
Yes, Mr. Vice President.
The cabinet's just voted. It's a split. I have to make a difficult decision.
Yes, sir.
I don't want to make an uninformed judgment at this critical point. You're closest to the action. You have an understanding of this man. I want your recommendation.
Well, I don't know what to say.
You seem to have a point of view when we first spoke today.
Oh, I realize that, sir.
O'Connor, we can't waste time. You've got 5 minutes.
Adam?
Joan?
Joan?
How are you?
Well, you're never going to believe it, darling, but right now I'm sitting here picking cotton.
What?
How are you?
I'm fine. Darling? Darling?
You know, I've been thinking,
We haven't really had very much of a chance to really see each other in these last couple of weeks.
Well, darling, you have been pretty busy.
Yeah, well, that's no excuse.
What I was thinking was, when I get out of here, the first thing we're going to do is go up to Camp David. You remember last year when we went up there with the Hilliards and you faked that sprained ankle so that we could,
Adam, darling.
What's the matter? You getting bashful?
Boy, you weren't very bashful that night after we,
Darling, it's just that you're on the loudspeaker.
Oh, no.
If I just adjust this a little, you'll have a little more privacy.
Thank you. Darling, are you still there?
No, I've gone to Chicago.
Can I join you?
Boy, that's the first good laugh I've had all day.
There's our girl. Hasn't moved yet. There's our agent.
Jesus, guy, play it cool.
Where's our actress, Ian?
She's coming towards the camera, sir.
Huh. Not a bad actress, huh?
Shouldn't we inform Mackenzie?
Mackenzie's a fool. You'd have to think about it for 3 days. This is our chance. It may never come again. No, I want to see his face when I show him how it's done.
What about O'Connor, sir?
Fuck O'Connor.
Get out now! Get out now! Come on!
Got her. And it didn't blow.
He did what?
They're bringing her up now.
Gentlemen!
I pressed it! I pressed the detonator, I know I did!
But it didn't work, did it?
The whole thing is a hoax. It is a giant bluff designed to embarrass the government of the United States. But it is over, and you are finished!
I think not, Mr. Dick. It has just begun. If you ask your president, with whom I'm sure you're in voice contact with by now, you'll discover that the timing device has been activated. What you have just done, in fact, gentlemen, is you have just reduced your president's remaining hours on Earth. The truck will explode in less than 3 hours, midnight. Get this off me, please.
She didn't have time to set the detonator. She's lying. She's lying!
Why didn't you tell me? Why?
I told you all you needed to know.
Yes, damn it, it's ticking. It started about 15 minutes ago.
Thank you, Mr. President. We'll have you out of there very soon.
Out.
What the hell's the matter with you? Playing Russian roulette with the president's life?
While you experts are running around, bumping into walls, I took a course of action.
Dietrich, the president's life is my responsibility.
Jerry, top priority.
Got it.
You bloody fool.
I'll take it to my office. When I get back, I want this man gone.
I'm arranging a VIP escort for you to the airport.
I tell you what.
Take the cuffs off.
Jerry, is this plan feasible?
Well, to be perfectly frank with you, I'm not too damn sure. But with the truck set to blow at midnight, we just can't let the president sit there.
All right. I authorize you to go ahead with anything you see fit. On my responsibility.
Thank you, Mr. Vice President.
You're going to get your ransom, buddy.
But you fuck me around, and I'll rip your heart out.
What are you doing?
I'm going to show you something. You can't get on a plane with them.
You'll end up like your sister. How do we get into the truck? Okay, you got your diamonds. Now, how do we get into the truck?
Oh, good. So you can shoot me down. No, my friend. I will radio instructions half hour after takeoff.
You son of a bitch.
Get out. On behalf of the revolution. Thank you.
What revolution? Huh? The Monteverdi have publicly condemned your actions. This is not their revolution, Sandy. It's your own private war.
It's lies.
You want to talk about lies? Let's talk about Erica Steiner. Ask him how she was killed.
Shot. Fighting for the revolution.
Her throat was cut. Tell me how to get into the truck. Please tell me how to get into the truck.
I don't know! I don't know. You didn't tell me anything. I don't know.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you.
We've caught the kidnappers. And we're going to try and torch through to you from underneath.
Mm-hmm.
cool off. Sucker heats up in a hurry.
Tell him to stop the torch. The whole damn floor is wired.
Yes, sir.
Herman, the firewall between the engine and the cab, is it armored? Come on, is it armored?
No, you don't need no armor there. That engine would stop any bullet.
Come on with me. Nice and easy. What'll it take to get this engine out of here?
You mean right out?
Right out. I want to go in through the firewall.
Right. In simple terms, you take off a few screws, nip a few wires, pull the rat out. Engine should drop right out.
When it drops, will it hit the frame?
I can't guarantee that it won't.
That's enough to set off the movement sensors.
You ain't got that much time. Just over half an hour.
Bring it in, bring it in! Take it off. We need some help.
Gentle.
Goes both ways.
Watch it.
That's how you know about the wires.
Yeah, come on. I figured if anybody's gonna blow this thing up, it might as well be me. What are you doing in here anyway? Why don't you send an expert with those clippers?
Thank you.
I want to tell you, I got a lot of respect for the way you handle this situation. I'm impressed. Ethan, about your resignation.
It's on your desk.
Tear it up.
Adam. Ah, hello, darling.
How did we ever go this far? You touch my hand and start the car. And for the first time in my life, I'm crying. Are we in space? Do we belong? Someplace where no one calls it wrong. And like the stars we burn away the miles. The shame of this whole world. How did we ever go this far? You touched my hand and start the car.